It takes a village to create Inside the Activist Studio, so we encourage you to join us in this project of recovering the history of radical resistance in this country. We talk about love all the time, but if you really know something about love, you know that love begins with yourself. And self-defense is the premise upon which self-love is built. And black people and indigenous people and oppressed people around the world have to defend their lives and themselves, but they're criminalized. Ruggiero, who's an editor at City Lights, the house that published Loaded, for asking me to read this book. I was reading it, and I was riveted. I was so riveted that I was like, I know that this book is not supposed to be out, but I need to let the campaign read it. I distributed it. We did send it online. And we had a reading group in the campaign about it, and that is part of what brought us here. So without further ado, I think the author really needs to talk about this phenomenal work that's going to change the historiography of American history and of the American Revolution. So without further ado, I think the author really needs to talk about this phenomenal work that's going to change the historiography of American history and of the American Revolution. So without further ado, I think the author really needs to talk about this phenomenal work that's going to change the historiography of American history and of the American Revolution. I want you to tell us, which I wanted you to tell us more in the book, tell us a little bit about yourself. How did you get to Loaded? What's the personal narrative that brought you here?
Thank you, Johanna. And thanks to all of you for being here. It's a real honor to be a part of this, sponsored by this wonderful group. And Johanna and I have actually done a panel together before a couple of years ago at the Left Forum. So I feel like we're back in our groove here. I'm very honored that that the book is useful to the work of the committee. And it's fine that you read it, but you should read it again because it has improved since the first draft that was sent out. I'm a 60s veteran, I'm an unlikely 60s veteran, I'm a 60s person, I think, because of the background I came from. I never, until I started meeting African-Americans from the South in the civil rights movement, met another person in the movement who came from a tenant farming family and in Oklahoma. So that was, it's a very different experience. And I did have some teachings in socialism because my grandfather was a Wobbly and he was in the Socialist Party in Oklahoma. And he was a kind, you know, a farmer with 9 children. So even, you know, that profile of who's a Wobbly is also kind of stereotyped as, and my father told me stories about his name. His name is Moyer Haywood Pettibone Scarberry Dunbar. And those are the founders of the IWW, the Wobblies. I had that. I also, in Oklahoma, it was once Indian Territory. settlers who came in there, like my my father's family. My father was born there, but the year they came, 1907, the land of the Native people had been allotted. The ethnic cleansing east of the Mississippi, forcing all of the people out. You've heard of the Trail of Tears, but there were multiple Trails of Tears, 50 different Native nations rounded up and forced into to live in Indian territory under Andrew Jackson's presidency. So this is a very mixed situation. We also had freedmen from the Civil War, actually soldiers, combat veterans, who were given allotments by the federal government in Oklahoma. So the tenant farmers in Oklahoma were white, black, and Indian. And sometimes they came together for rebellions, for some interesting things I tell about in the other book, Indigenous People's History of the United States. And I also did a memoir about my childhood, Red Dirt Growing Up Okie, that tells the story of Oklahoma. But fortunately for me, I think coming from this background with very little knowledge about the world outside of Canadian County, Oklahoma, or even a part of Canadian County, Oklahoma, and before any kind of telecommunications, and when the press was very censored in Oklahoma by the oil industry, and the only radio station and newspaper was owned by, it was really an oligarchy that took over from, you know, that defeated the socialists and the Wobblies and took over, and it was an industrialized place. It's the civil rights movement. When I moved to Oklahoma City for my last year of high school, in the first integrated high school in Oklahoma, Central High School in Oklahoma City, there was a wonderful young African-American leader of the sit-ins, which preceded the ones they were the first ones in Oklahoma in 1956-57. Sit-ins in the big drugstore there, and her name was Claire Looper. And I'd see pictures of her in the paper, and I said, that's who I want to be, that's what I want to be. Whatever she's doing, that was my role model. This activist wasn't much older than me, and she was about 19, and I was 16. So I did get involved, and there were race riots in that school against the black students that were brought over from the black school. It's the first time I had to take sides in something, sort of this, whose side are you on? Because it was either you were with the racists who were ugly and beating up on destroying the lockers and stalking the women students, and they were so, you know, very well prepared by the movement to deal with this. But they were real role models. So this was this is a very poor school, by the way, all working class students. It was the downtown school. Everyone worked. It was a trade school, basically. And I worked full-time while I went my senior year of school. So that was really, it was then an aspiration. Where do I sign up for this? You know, how do I get involved? And I always remember this because it's not that easy. Movements can be very insular and not welcome. You know, someone who looks different, like this was the time of Jackie Kennedy soon, and that's how I wanted to look, you know, with a little shift dress and a bouffant hairdo. And so I was a unicorn, you know. It was kind of tough, but I was really determined. And then I moved to San Francisco in 1960 and went to San Francisco State University, which became better known as an activist place in 68, but it already was. The Hallinan brothers and Willie Brown had just graduated there. And so they're doing redlining. I got involved in that. So this is how, but by how the book starts is by 1970, a lot had changed in the movement. We didn't know exactly what COINTELPRO was, but when we found out later, it made a lot of things a lot clearer that was happening, so we got pretty paranoid. And so we armed ourselves. I was based in New Orleans, organizing out of New Orleans, and our partners, our group were the Republic of New Africa, Virginia Collins, and Walter Collins, really amazing people. So we, after the Black Panthers and the Ninth Ward were held up and almost like the MOVE situation, really trying to wipe them out, we started getting threats from the Ku Klux Klan. David Duke was new on the block as the Klansman and calling us, and he was based in New Orleans, threatening us, threatening to bomb. So we started getting guns. So I call the first chapter Gun Love, because we kind of, these guns kind of distorted our politics, because New Orleans is very humid. We had to clean these guns all the time, oil them, polish them. And I think, you know, they started becoming like pets. Got very attached to them. And I came to realize later that that's part of the gun nuttery in the United States, the permission to have guns. It's sort of like, cocaine or something. It's empowering, but it's not always has a purpose. You know, it can sort of distort your purpose of whether you need them or not. So that went on for about 2 years. So I tell about how that proceeded, and you know, going to the gun shows and the kind of people there, the Confederate flags and swastikas and all.